There are many unsolved mysteries as to just how life on Earth got started. It's one of the greatest unanswered questions in science. Some of these mysteries are obscured by the basic reality that most of Earth's surface, from the early days of life, is no longer here. It has subducted or weathered away, leaving us with precious little geology from that period to study. There are a few hints, however. Zircon crystals found in certain parts of the world are so tough that they can survive almost anything, and preserve clues as to what Earth's early history was like, such as evidence of water on the planet's surface only a few hundred million years after the Earth's formation, deepening the question of just how Earth got its water in the first place, but also the presence of carbon isotopes, believed to be biogenic, meaning an indicator of life, some potentially as old as 4.1 billion years. Life was here very early in the history of this world. That's only about 500 million years after the Earth formed, and during most of that time period, Earth was inhospitable, molten, and subject to constant bombardment by debris from the formation of the solar system. The thing is, it seems very suspiciously fast that a planet that was still not all that clement could have life arise at the very earliest possible time it could. That can mean several things. The first is that it's chemically not hard for life to arise on a planet, and it's just a natural end result of organic chemistry. That would suggest a simple and straightforward process. But if it's a simple process, then why has it been so difficult to figure out? We've been doing experiments related to abiogenesis for a solid 60 or more years. And while we have a lot more clues these days, we don't have a definitive answer, and we are nothing close to reproducing what happened in the lab. We can do parts of it, but not the whole process. So if it were simple, you'd think we would have a decent abiogenesis overall model, and we'd have new life popping out of test tubes, and we don't. Another possibility is that it means that Earth simply got lucky, and the conditions just happened to be just right to allow life to arise and explode fast enough to get a foothold. In other words, a fluke. That may be the case, but it comes with huge statistical problems. We just end up incredibly unlikely to be here, yet we are. And not only that, but again, the process happened just as soon as it possibly could. Yet in that framework, it doesn't happen that way elsewhere very much. And that doesn't seem likely, and nothing about the universe that we see says that should be the case. There are no definitive solid physical or chemical brick walls there. There are only great filter maybes. The last possibility is that life was not originally from here, and was deposited here from space, one way or another. For a natural mechanism, this is the famous panspermia concept, where microbial life, spores, travel across space in rocks blasted from the surface of inhabited bodies, moving from one planet to another, infecting the second body with life when meteorites fall. This is a hugely open question because the solar system actually does have multiple bodies that do, or have in the past, held conditions for life to exist, and do indeed sneeze on each other. The list is huge. Mars, Venus, the ice shell moons like Europa, Enceladus, and quite a few others, and even the Kuiper Belt objects, all have internal sources of heat and can maintain liquid water at some level that could allow for some kind of panspermic interaction between them and Earth. Mars being the favorite candidate here because we have meteorites on Earth that originated there, showing proof of concept, though no definitive evidence of past life on Mars has ever been found. It's going to be interesting indeed on this count because if we never find any current or past evidence of life elsewhere in the solar system, then the chances of life being indigenous to Earth greatly rise, but you still can't actually prove it. One of the reasons for this is that we don't actually know how resilient alien life can be, but we do know that spores can be viable from Earth for a very long time. There have been claims of millions of years old spores preserved on Earth being revived. That's well enough to not only cross the solar system, but the Milky Way galaxy itself. That opens up another avenue for panspermia. Early on, the solar system was part of the sun's birth cluster. There was a star-forming region, a nebula, where multiple stars formed close together and then dispersed. Indeed, we have some very good candidates for stars that chemically show that they originated in the same cluster as the Sun. It's possible that life originally arose at another member of the cluster and was transferred here through an impact in another system. That's completely on the table. This all has an interesting implication in that if there is a massive population of rocks containing life moving throughout the galaxy, then interstellar life becomes ubiquitous. It would be microbial and almost certainly dormant, but would quite simply be an example of natural interstellar travel in suspended animation, and our microbial spores already have that ability. They can in principle travel to stars far better than we can, even though we're a technological spacefaring species that actually understands what interstellar travel actually is. Where this will get interesting is when we begin to discover and study interstellar objects in detail and actually get samples from them. It is possible that some analog of a spore or otherwise dormant or potentially active alien microbe could be discovered on an object like Oumuamua or in a meteorite of interstellar origin. We may never know where those microbes are from. We'd only know that they are not genetically related to Earth, and they would be from parts unknown somewhere out there. But there are yet other possibilities. Some people might point out that we can't actually rule out that life was intentionally seeded on this planet very early on. This is actually a more complicated problem than you might think, because it actually includes several different possibilities. Yes, it's true that we can't rule out intentional seeding, but it also pays to remember that intentional seeding is also a form of panspermia. You could call it artificial or technological panspermia that represents one way or another one planet exporting its biosphere to another. What the genomes of Earth do not show, however, is any obvious or major design or manipulation. Rather, the DNA of this world is rather messy and looks exactly like what you might expect from a fully natural chemical process. For manipulation, you would expect to see at least the remnants of a fundamentally streamlined genome. Because, well, that's what we're doing today in genetics. There have been experiments to reduce microbes to the bare minimum genome they need to function. And those experiments were all able to shave a lot of DNA out. In fact, almost all of it to get there. As a result, the vast majority of our DNA has no identifiable purpose, so far as we currently know. And it's just there. But that opens up another eerie possibility. More on that in a bit. All of this, however, doesn't preclude an accidental transfer of life by a technological species. We may have done this ourselves with our probes to other planets. It's entirely possible that there was living biological contamination present that ended up in the environment of a planet like Mars. That said, it seems unlikely anything from Earth likely to end up on a lander is going to survive very long, and certainly not thrive on the surface of Mars. But had Earth been visited by an alien species in the early days, perhaps noticing this world was prime for an abiogenesis event, and they sneezed and the genome of their microbes was fully natural, then yeah, it can't be ruled out. But then there is another level. If you think about it, the transfer of life from one world to another really constitutes a transfer of information. DNA is just information storage in the end, but at the same time, it is extremely efficient as a storage medium, and it's molecular, meaning it's extraordinarily tiny and efficient. And once you have it, it doesn't really cost that much to send it out into the stars and rocks, or even artificial arcs, to seed other worlds. And perhaps more intriguingly, as a means of communication. It's often pointed out as a criticism of radio SETI that aliens may simply not use radio, having graduated to something else we haven't thought of before. And that's a fair point. They might. And another point that's been made is that aliens may not be transmitting at the frequencies in SETI that we look, especially at the hydrogen line, because our technology has actually moved away from the range of frequencies where it sits, because higher frequencies are better for downlinks and the like in the modern satellite age. As a result, the only thing going for it that's still standing since it was first suggested is the fact that it is a signpost frequency in nature, where someone might choose to put a signal because everyone in the galaxy knows that neutral hydrogen emits radio at this frequency. It's simply a natural place to look, or so we see it that way. But there are other problems, and a huge one is that radio is really inefficient. unless you're building a gigantic beacon with massive amounts of energy available, something we do not see in the galaxy, then transmissions would be targeted. The aliens would need to know what star system to send the signal to, and it would weaken at a distance, and that may not be how advanced alien species do it. In thinking about what other ways aliens can communicate beyond radio, one possibility is they might do it via information transfer panspermia. One way to communicate cheaply, in fact almost costlessly, is through intentional panspermia. And the potential for information storage by using genetic material is staggering. A single bacteria can contain up to 14 megabytes of information. If you get a gram of them, it's 900 terabytes, which is many hundreds of times what our current electronic storage is capable of in density. If all of the bacteria contained in a medium, such as a micro spacecraft, contained the same information, then that greatly increases the chances that data will survive 100,000 years or so in space, which at reasonable speeds translates to about 10 light years. And that's just where the efficiency begins. So imagine if you had a spacecraft full of bacteria that was small enough to be an efficient solar or laser sail, something Breakthrough Starshot is looking into with exploring Alpha Centauri. Such a micro spacecraft, sent out in huge numbers, could seed worlds that are suitable, and just crash on worlds that aren't, and then colonize and replicate. Then during impacts, that information-carrying bacteria could get ejected from that world, in impacts, and travel via otherwise natural panspermia to other worlds, seeding them too. And then you have close stellar encounters. Stars move, and they often pass in close proximity to each other well enough for panspermia to happen, without the enormous distances of interstellar space. The Sun has been through many thousands of these encounters over its lifetime, and it's entirely possible that a rock carrying microbes from the star system seeded, in the past, a passing star system with life, or vice versa. And then there is the question of time. The universe is 13.8 billion years old, and has had planets suitable to spawn life for a huge portion of that time. Panspermia may have been happening since life first arose, wherever in the universe, and that there's just life everywhere in the universe on a microbial scale. And when it goes beyond that and ends up as a civilization, they may have been sending out information for billions of years, meaning that if there were ever anyone in the Milky Way doing this, then almost certainly it made it here, and there is some evidence in the solar system somewhere deliberately placed, waiting for us to find it. The solution to the Fermi paradox here is very simple. It's here, it's microbial, and we simply haven't looked for it yet. We're a long way from meaningfully doing SETI searches in this way. We aren't even able to eliminate the possibility of a second abiogenesis or shadow biosphere here on Earth, because the methods we use to study life wouldn't detect it. But I leave you with a spooky open mystery. In all the studying we have done of life on Earth, the simplest life we find are bacteria. That's fully proven anyway. There are some controversial instances of what may be life that are open questions. But the thing is that even a single-celled bacteria isn't all that simple. It's actually rather complex. So where is the evidence for any precursors? We simply haven't found it. One ready solution to this question is that it doesn't exist, because the bacteria were deposited here from space. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about marooned bacteria. If this scenario is correct, then life in the galaxy literally works on the rule of life getting deposited on everything, but only very rarely returning to its home world, if it even still exists. Seems tragic in a way. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.